محمد وآل محمد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية أمير المؤمنين والأئمة المعصومين عليهم السلام ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين خاتم النبيين شفيع المذنبين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم مصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من يوم عداوتهم إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الحكيم وهو أصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولله الأسماء الحسنى فادعوه بها آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم اللهم صل على محمد السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته I begin in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no doubt that it's due to His kindness and generosity who gives us opportunities such as these where we gather together in remembrance of Him tabaraka wa ta'ala. Inshallah today we will discuss two more names, time permitting. The first name that we will discuss of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Jameel. Al-Jameel. Now many people I'm sure we know who are named Jameel. We often hear this used all the time, so we know what it means. It means beautiful. And as always, whenever we discuss it with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this one word translation does not do justice to what the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means. So for example, we get a tradition reported from Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Where he says, Inna Allaha Jameelun Yuhibbul Jamal. He says, surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Jameel and He loves all that which is beautiful. So when we look at this name in relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we find that this name is a name which gathers and encompasses all of the attributes of action, all of the attributes of beauty, all of the attributes of perfection into one name, and that is the name of Jameel. And when you study the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a whole, there are 99, but then if you look at Dua Joshan, there is 1,000 names of Allah. So there's an unlimited names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran has so many names as well. They are usually broken up into two different groups. There is the Sifatul Jamal and Sifatul Jalal. Yeah? The Sifatul Jamal are the attributes of beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anything that has to do with mercy, with His giving, His kindness, His benefiction, all of these things have to do with the attributes of Jamal. While the attributes of Jalal are the attributes of majesty. They have to do with His power, His Qudra. Yeah, these type are fall into the bracket of Jalal. So that is why when we say Jameel is a name which is all-encompassing, because all of the attributes of beauty fall under this name of Jamal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what does it mean that when we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Jameel? It doesn't mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beautiful. It means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beauty. Yeah? There's a difference between these two. It is one thing to say He is beautiful, it is something else to say He is beauty. It is something else to say He is knowledgeable, but to say that He is knowledge is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not beautiful, He is beauty in itself. Therefore, everything which emanates from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beauty. Yeah? There is nothing qabih which comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing ugly which comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything that comes from Him is beauty. Why? Because He subhanahu wa ta'ala is beauty. If we just look at the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We find, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Sajda, الَّذِي أَحْسَنَ كُلُّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقَ. It is He who has made everything that He created beautiful, He says. Perfect, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. And look at the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, we can look at it simply from the creation of a human being. Yeah? Imagine the khalq that we have, how perfect it is, and it's fit for purpose, isn't it? Imagine if we had three legs, how uncomfortable that would be. Now imagine if we had two heads, imagine how comfortable that. But He has created us beautifully and perfectly. Now if you look at the way the body runs inside, everything is dependent on one another, created absolutely perfectly. This is just the physical body that we are talking about. When we look at the spiritual perfection that one can reach, it is nothing but beauty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us an unlimited path to reach close to Him. Yeah, this is beauty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we even take a further step than that, if we look at just creation as a whole, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qaf, verses 7 and 8, وَالْأَرْضَ مَدَدْنَاهَا وَأَلْقَيْنَا فِيهَا رَوَاسِيَا وَأَنْبَتْنَا فِيهَا مِنْ كُلِّ زَوْجٍ بَهِيجٍ تَبْصِرَةً وَذِكْرَى لِكُلِّ عَبْدٍ مُنِيبٍ. He says, and we spread out the earth, yes, and cast in it firm mountains, and caused every delightful kind to grow in it. In this there is a lesson, an insight, an admonition for every penitent servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the beauty all around us. Yes, we just drive and we see nothing but beauty. If we go an hour, we have one of the seven wonders of the world here in Niagara Falls. We are lucky human beings to be able to understand and see the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, sometimes it just requires for us to focus and realize what it is that we are looking at. If we want more examples of the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at how beautiful His actions with us are. If we just look at, for example, His action of sustenance, how beautiful it is. Where He provides for every single creature of His. There is not a creature who does not go provided for by Allah, except it is provided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, sometimes, and I'm sure many will attest to this, we feel like we are in a burden. We feel like we are tight with our money because maybe it is coming to that month end and we've run out of money. But we still find a way to survive. How? It is Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. It is not us who do anything. It is not us who now start living thriftily. No, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who stretches that little rizq enough until we get some more rizq that is provided. This is the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if we look at, for example, His mercy, His forgiveness, who can deny that there is nothing but beauty in that of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I've repeated this over and over again in the course of these lectures, but we are those people who, as I said, gain a little bit and think that we have gotten a lot. I gain a little bit of knowledge and I think now that I am more knowledgeable than anybody else. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks all past all that. Yeah? He looks past my ignorance and yet He provides for me. Yet He is merciful to me. Yet He forgives me if I turn repentance towards Him. These are no doubt attributes of beauty coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what do we take from this name then? How can we connect with this name of Jameel? First, our duty should be that we have to recognize the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in everything. Yes, not only in the surroundings that we have. Just take a walk. Yeah, sometimes we fail to walk because we live almost in a concrete jungle. Yeah, we are driving on concrete and pavement, we get into our house, we don't get a chance to go outside and look at the beauty. You know, I'm from LA, Los Angeles, and in Los Angeles there is one season, hot, that's it. But subhanAllah, we live in Toronto now, yeah? I live in Toronto where we all live. We get four seasons, we see the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala change month after month. We need to recognize this. We need to open our eyes and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity. And then as I said last time as well, we need to find the beauty in one another. Yeah? When we look at a fellow believer, I need to see inside your heart and find that which is beautiful inside you. And that is difficult in the month of Ramadan, right? Because we're all grumpy by the time the fast is ending. But if I look hard, I will find something. Because why? You are the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we said, there is nothing but beauty which comes from Allah. Therefore, I must find the beauty inside of you. Another task that I have is to make sure that my conduct is beautiful. Yes? My akhlaq, my morals, my mannerisms, everything about me should be beautiful. I should take those extra steps to refine my characteristics, to refine my intelligence. And again, this is the month of tests, yes? What is amazing, you know, I always find people tell me, and this is a reality, that during the month of Ramadan, it is difficult for us to function, yes? We slow down. Our brain slows down, it feels like. It doesn't slow down, but we slow down. So we blame it on the fasting that it has slowed down. But if you look at the reality, if you look at the ahadith, hunger is one of those things which is extremely praised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says it will bring you closer to me if we are in a state of hunger. That would mean that our intellect would work better in a state of hunger. The fact that our intellect works slower in the month of Ramadan is because we have not understood these ahadith. We have rather caved into our stomachs for 11 months that when we do fast for that 12th month, it doesn't work the way it's supposed to be working. Yeah? So it is we who need to refine our characteristics, our intellect, our understanding so that we also become Jameel. Another thing that we can do is, this is highly recommended, is we dress beautifully as well. Yeah, this is highly important in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want us to look raggedy. He does not want us to look like we have just woken up and just come to mosque. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to look beautiful. And we find so many ahadith telling us this. For example, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, ma salla ala. He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى جَمِيلٌ يُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ وَيُحِبُّ أَنْ يَرَى أَثَرَ نِعْمَتِهِ عَلَى عَبْدِهِ. SubhanAllah. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beautiful, is beauty, and He loves to see beauty in His ibad, in His servants. Yes? And He loves to see the effects of His bounties that He has provided for you. He does not like to see you as if nothing has been provided to you. Yeah? When we dress in a manner like that, it is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not provided me with any bounties. Allah says, I don't like to see you in that state. I have provided for you. Act accordingly. I have provided you to look good and dress good. Act accordingly and don't act in a way which humiliates Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we know, there's one of my favorite hadith comes from our sixth Imam, Imam Jaffar al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Where he says, "Kunu zainan lana, wala takunu shainan alayna." Yeah, he says, "Be beautifying ornaments for us, the Ahlul Bayt, but don't be a disappointment for us." That means when people see us, they should think of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam highly. Because why? We are the Shias of the Ahlul Bayt. Don't make them look at us and say, "Ah, these Ahlul Bayt must not be good people because of our conduct." Yeah? The same applies. When I act in a way as though I don't have anything, I am insulting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we must be careful not to behave in this manner. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Ma salla ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. The next name that we will discuss, and now I'm going ahead, I've skipped, I'm not going alphabetically anymore. And since my last lecture, I wanted to pick something which connects with this, with a topic that I picked something else basically, I'm not going alphabetically. The name that we pick now is Al-Haleem, yeah? Al-Haleem. Now I know we're fasting, yeah? And right away you go, oh, Haleem. Yeah, I was very cautious of this. I said, oh, do I want to pick this name? But khair, inshallah. Haleem. This is one of the beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, if we look at the laws of humanity, yes? Most of the laws that we have an effect right away. Yes. So for example, the laws of civilization, not civilization, just the earth. If I, for example, Na'udhu billah, if somebody takes poison, the effect of that poison will be faced right away. Yes? If somebody breaks the law and they're caught, the effect of that will be right away. However, when we look at the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes, we violate and violate the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet that punishment does not come down right away. Yes? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Fatir, verse number 45, وَلَوْ يُؤَاخِذُ اللَّهُ النَّاسَ بِمَا كَسَبُوا مَا تَرَكَ عَلَىٰ ذَهْرِهَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ Subhanallah. وَلَكِنْ يُؤَخِّرَهُمْ إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِعِبَادِهِ بَصِيرًا He says, were Allah to take mankind to task because of what they had done, there would not be a single creature left upon this earth. Imagine. Yeah? If He punished us right away for the things that we have done, Allah says there'll be nobody left upon this earth. But He says, I am giving everybody a respite. I am giving everybody a chance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. And this is because He is known as Haleem. Because He is forbearant. Because He controls His anger. And this is one of the most beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It appears in the Quran over a dozen times. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, says, وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلِيمًا حَلِيمًا He says, surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is alim, most knowledgeable, yet that knowledge is coupled with hilm, yeah, forbearance. That means even though we deserve punishment right away, He holds back on that punishment because of His forbearant nature. Now, we must remember something very important, and that's that there is a difference between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving us a grace and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala overlooking our actions. Yeah? He is not overlooking our actions. We will be held accountable for everything. But He is giving us a grace period. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ibrahim, verse number 42, وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ اللَّهَ غَافِلًا Yeah, don't consider Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala غافل, that He is overlooking anything. عَمَّا يَعْمَلْ الظَّالِمُونَ إِنَّمَا يُؤَخِّرُهُمْ لِيَوْمِ تَشْخَصُ فِيهِ الْأَبْصَارِ He says, do not suppose that Allah is oblivious to what the wrongdoers are doing. He is only granting them respite until the day when the eyes will be glazed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. So He is not giving, He is not overlooking anything that we are doing. Rather, when we look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His servants, He is giving them time for them to do istighfar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we look at, for example, again Surah Ibrahim, verse number 10, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَتْ رُسُلُهُمْ أَفِي اللَّهِ شَكْ فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ يَدْعُوكُمْ لِيَغْفِرَ لَكُمْ مِنْ ذُنُوبِكُمْ Yeah, He says, do you have doubt in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Indeed, He is merely giving you a break so that you will do istighfar to Him. Now, these are His servants, but there are those who are even more closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the chosen servants. And when we look at ahadith, it tells us that the chosen servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are not given a break by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their azab is felt right away. Yeah? And this comes from, for example, our sixth Imam, Imam Jaffar al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Imam salli ala Muhammad. He says, إِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ بِعَبْدٍ خَيْرًا عَجَّلَ لَهُ أُقُوبَتُهُ He says, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted khair, wanted goodness for His servants, He would hasten the punishment towards them. Yeah? He would not hold back on the punishments. وَإِذَا أَرَادَ بِعَبْدٍ سُوءًا أَمْسَكَ عَلَيْهِ ذُنُوبَهُ حَتَّى يُوَافِيَ بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ Allahu Akbar. But He says, but if He wanted to punish His servants, He would hold back on their sins until He made them pay for it on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. This is constantly reminded to us by the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. They say to us, if you see that your life does not have tests, if you see that your life is not full of obstacles, look towards Allah and do istighfar because Allah is letting you go, they say. Yeah? But if you are constantly faced with challenges and obstacles, know that you are doing something right because He is constantly trying you. We always must remember that. If we were not worthy of tests, Allah would not test us. If He did not find us close to Him, He would not spend time, waste time upon us. But the fact that He tests us shows us that He still has love for us and still has closeness and affection for us. So now what is our role with this name? Quite simple. We need to be forbearing and gentle with everyone. This is difficult. Especially as I said, in fasting, we get tested all the time. Things that would normally never upset us in the holy month of Ramadan. Why? Because we have not eaten. We have not drunk. Very animalistic, if you think about it, isn't it? That because we don't eat and drink, we behave like animals. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us to be Haleem at all times, especially with our family members. You know, who do we take most of our anger out on? On those we love. Yeah, it's an unfortunate reality. Outside, you may bother me, I'll go home and take it out on my child. Yeah? Why? Because I can. Yeah? That's the problem. Here I can't do it to you, but I can do it to the family members that I love. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam says, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. He says, لا تعاجل الذنب بالعقوبة واجعل بينهما للاعتذار طريقا. He says, do not hasten to punish people for the mistakes that they make. Instead, give them a time so that they may make an excuse or repent for that which they have done. Yeah, this is very important. What do? Somebody makes a mistake, right away we want to slap them. It's a mistake. That is why they call it an accident. Yeah? If it wasn't an accident, they wouldn't call it an accident because we didn't intend to do it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who gives us such a grace, you think that we would be able to turn around and give the same grace to people. We need to do this. We need to let people make excuses and turn repentant for what they have done. This is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something that we need to do. Secondly, it is very important to remember that Hilm, one is only Haleem when they have the power to do something. For example, if I am under a rule of an oppressor and a tyrant, yes, and then I say, I am being Haleem. No, I'm not being Haleem. I have no choice but to be like this, yes. Haleem is only when I have the power to do something and I held back that power because I want to be forbearant. Yes, so this is very important. Otherwise, I'm being patient. Yes, Haleem is very different. Hilm is different than Sabr. Sabr is when you have no choice and you're patient. Hilm is when you have a choice and yet you are being forbearant. And when we look at examples of those who are Haleem, we look at the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. And tonight after Maghrib will be the 15th of the holy month of Ramadan, where it will be the wiladat of our second Imam, Imam Al-Hasan alayhi as-salam. And one of his titles is Haleem Ahlul Bayt. He is the most forbearant of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, because he was able to hold back and let go of the things that people were doing for him. And there's one beautiful story, I'll end with this. A man comes from Sham. And as we know, in Sham, the people did not like the Ahlul Bayt. It was no secret. The people had animosity and bughd towards Ahlul Bayt. In fact, it was in Sham that when, as we know, when Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam was struck in the mihrab and the news reached Sham that he was killed in a mosque, the people of Sham said, Ali was praying? What was Ali doing in the mosque? Why? Because Muawiyah had brainwashed the people to believe in these lies. So when this Shami comes to Medina and he sees Imam Al-Hasan alayhi salam, he begins to curse Imam's father. Yes? Begins to call him all types of filth. And the Imam alayhi salam listens. And then the Imam turns around and says, Ayyuha Shaykh, Adhannuka Ghariba. He says, oh, Sheikh, you know, Sheikh is not just for somebody who is a scholar. Sheikh is also used in Arabic to describe somebody who is elderly. So he says to him, Ayyuha Sheikh, it looks to me like you are a stranger. Yeah? And then he says, لَوْ سَأَلْتَنَا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ وَلَوْ إِسْتَرْشَدْتَنَا أَرْشَدْنَاكَ. And he continues in this manner. He says, if you had asked us, we would have provided for you. If you are hungry, we will provide you food. If you need transportation, we will provide you transport. And he continues in this manner, completely giving everything away to this man until the Shami begins to cry and says, indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows where he has kept his risalah. And this is how the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam won over the enemies and those who had bogs for them because of their hilm and kindness. Wa akhiru da'wan and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he hasten the reappearance of our imam. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he forgive the sins of our parents and our loved ones. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who are going through oppression, that he end their oppression. And lastly, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we leave this month of Ramadan not the same way that we entered the month of Ramadan. Wa akhiru da'wan and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Rahimallahu man qara'a surat al-mubarakat al-fatiha.